Hi and welcome to the Turning Stone Show, where we talk about subjects that matter to you, about spiritual consciousness evolving. Man, am I excited. We have the number one international best-selling author, Robert Tremblay, here with us today. He's a near-death experiencer. Can't wait for you to hear his story. So this is gonna be really, really exciting. Glad you're here. Guiding the ship today is Jesse Farrell, myself, David, and our special co-host is Tarly Reed. She's awesome. Give me knuckles, girl.
Boom. Thank you.
So Robert is amazing. I want you to hear about his book. Robert, give us a little context about who you are and what you do.
Sure. My battle started 6 years ago, and it's just been a continual journey through several terminal diagnoses, actually, and just the miraculous story involved in the whole deal. But it was just so much more than a near-death experience cause for me in this book, and I'm fairly sure that's why it went to the top of the Amazon charts. Yeah. In England and Canada and here, so.
Awesome, yeah. Awesome. So to give you some context about the book and some of the story in it, we've got a video for you to watch. I got to spend some time with Robert. I want you to hear this incredible story.
February 16th, 2011, I was diagnosed terminal with 6 weeks to live. I was transported back to my home state in Vermont so I could be close to family. And 3 weeks after my original diagnosis, I passed away in the intensive care unit at Fletcher Allen Hospital in Burlington, Vermont, for what seemed like 20 seconds. But for me, it seemed like eternity. I found myself in what appeared to be a dream state, in a large, dark expanse, with what appeared off in the distance to be a red, curved light that I either traveled to or it traveled to me. I could smell things in this dream. I could taste things. I could feel a vibration I had never experienced in my life. And a sense of peace I still to this day have difficulty explaining. There was a light that appeared over the precipice of this expanse, and it grew and grew. It was pure white. But a face emerged in that light, and there were words. In fact, I don't even remember anybody's lips moving, but there was a question from him, and honestly, I thought it was the face of God. There was no ambiguity where I was. I knew exactly what was happening. And to be honest with you, I'd already given up in my hospital bed. But that question loomed forever to me and still does. He just simply asked, "Are you ready?" I didn't think about it. I didn't even pause. And I immediately said no. And he began to smile, this giant face in this giant light. And I reached out and touched his face. I thought my teeth would fall out of my head. It was the most peaceful feeling I'd ever felt in my entire life. And it would be 2 years later, which is typically the average for most experiencers to realize what happened to them, was actually a near-death experience. Almost everything changed about me overnight. I recounted 15 pages before finding a picture 2 years later of a man I had never seen or remembered in my past, and it turned out to be the same man in that light. That man was my grandfather, who died 28 years before my birth. My mind went crazy when I put it all together, what had happened to me, and it justified a little bit about those 2 years and treatment and surviving the impossible. But the question wasn't the miracles of a near-death experience. The question really was the humility involved in sharing my entire story, which was, how exactly do you describe these miracles when you have no functioning immune system? You see, when I was diagnosed as a 41-year-old married man with end-stage AIDS. It'll capture your attention. I lived a promiscuous life. This isn't about rationalizing your mistakes, quote-unquote, in life. It's about getting the hell up and doing something with it that's going to change this world.
Wow, awesome. Robert, thank you so much.
Thank you. Really great job.
Dude, Amazon number one international bestseller. That's awesome.
It's surreal.
Tell me about this.
Yeah, you know, it's been just over a year and... You know, the whole thing was a collective journey, my survival, right down to publishing the book. It was so clear to me in that realm of a oneness that we all come back with. It just is so overpowering. It seems so relevant to my story, my survival, And there's just some real wild stuff in this thing that, you know, when I got here 2.5 years ago and started going to the Mayo Clinic, they just said, that's the part we can't explain.
Yeah.
And it's the shocking part about the book that took some humility and some courage to put it out there. And, you know, I think people responded to that vulnerability, and it was time to rekindle this conversation. Yeah. And I think your viewers will understand why.
Yeah. Now, we met Robert at the Academy for Spiritual and Consciousness Studies. There was a conference in Scottsdale back in December. And Jesse and I got to meet you there at the conference. It's about spiritual consciousness, continuing spiritual consciousness, evolving, as our slogan of our show is. And what I was impressed with, there's a group of people that already understand that when you die, your consciousness continues to go. A lot of people think, nope, boom, lights out, that's it. I lived here, did my thing, I'm an atheist, there's no God, boom, gone. And regardless of whatever a mindset was, you were somewhere doing something for a period of time.
Oh, indeed. The question was, how much time has always been the real kind of fun question that we've always had, the sense of time in that area. And I should be clear to all of you that, you know, prior to this experience, this was nothing on my radar. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to be, I just didn't have time for it, frankly, probably. But I don't know if I was a complete skeptic, but what I knew of a near-death experience was the, you know, the life flashing before your eyes, and I didn't get that, you know, so it was, it just was a wild experience, and it just happened almost like everything in the story in my survival after 6 years of countless diseases was at exactly the right time, manner, and sequence. Things showed up, and people showed up at the right time and place. And I paid attention. You know, I've always, you know, people, how did you do it? How did you do it? But the real funky part of the story really still remains that we see miracles like this all the time with near-death experiencers. The question remained for me was, how could you possibly do it without a functioning immune system? And it's not any big hero thing for me. My whole story is about the love that saved me. And I mean that. And I think it's important. So
what really struck me about this story is you were a straight white male. You were in a relationship with a spouse. And you contracted the HIV virus.
Yeah. And I'd probably had it for years. The real shocking aspect of the story was telling that part of it. You know, when I was diagnosed terminal, I was mortified. I was so ashamed. The fear and the, what have I done? And how could this be? And I remember being diagnosed and my first words out of my mouth, you know, you're being told to go get your affairs in order. And my first words out of my mouth, unbelievable. But I'm not gay. Come on, are you kidding me?
Can't be me.
And
I'm
it was
gay.
The whole point of the book, the story, why I was caught so late in the disease. And you know, surely we can do something about that. I mean, we're still talking about 65% of the population of HIV-infected people in this country have absolutely no idea they're even infected.
Really?
We can fix that.
Wow.
Right? I mean, now today we find, you know, new populations are the largest growing segment of new HIV infections for the last couple of years has been women. And right behind them now are senior citizens.
Yeah.
So come on.
Yeah.
I get it. Like me, 30 years ago, I said, not my circus. It just is not my problem.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to be rude or insensitive to that calling, but I think a lot of us did it.
Yeah.
And 30 years later, you know, 36 million are dead and 35 million are infected. And it's we can do better than that.
Yep.
And it's about, you know, trying to get rid of some of this stigma and not just associate it with, you know, how can I not be in the risk factor? I mean, if you're having sex, you're in the risk factor. Sorry. And I get one segment of the population was adversely affected. It's not against any population. It's just, if we're really going to make an impact on this disease that's now evolved, obviously now attacking our daughters and our granddaughters, That age of females, by the way, the newest, fastest growing population is 13 to 24 years of age.
Wow.
Stop.
Yeah.
I mean, the math alone is staggering in 5 years where we're going to be sitting here going, what happened here? I think some people think there's a cure, you know, functionally, because people are now living a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And there are great advancements that mm-hmm. people should know about and talk about, because it's another looming gap in our fight, to be honest with you, is the disparaging aspect of how many people aren't on this medication,
mm-hmm.
which is more than just saving their lives. It actually lowers your viral load, so passing the disease becomes almost impossible. And 72% of the population aren't on that medication who are now infected with HIV.
Wow.
So
The medication is insanely expensive unless you can get any kind of funding.
$6,000 is my two pills.
Wow.
Once a day, two pills. That's it.
For each pill, $6,000?
No, $6,000 is the whole month.
Oh, for the
just
month.
Just those two medications. Yeah.
And do you have insurances that cover that or subsidies? Or?
Well, the state actually has programs for under the Ryan White program, which is a huge charity with, they sponsor people who want help and assistance. They will help you with deductibles and copays, but you know, otherwise you're lumping the bill. No one's paying anything for you. It's, you know, you have to have good insurance. And you know, the ironic part of this story was I was diagnosed literally in the middle of the Obamacare passing. So I hadn't passed yet. So being diagnosed terminal with no health insurance, don't think it wasn't an issue. You know, by the time I got transported to Vermont, we had insurance now, and, you know, it was a month later, and then Obamacare passed, and pre-existing conditions became, you know, null and void. But that's a scary aspect to be diagnosed without health insurance and wonder, can you hide that?
So where were you at in your, where were you at, just talk a little bit about, like, physically with your health and what was going on with you that had you actually be diagnosed? Like, what's kind of that journey been? Because we skipped, like, right to, like, well, I, you know, but there was something,
The better part of a couple years prior, I had started losing weight, throwing up all the time, lamaze, just tired all the time, and I'm just not that guy. I just have, you know, I'm 1,000 miles an hour with my hair on fire. So there was obviously something wrong. And, you know, like most of us men, you know, we got to be beat over the head to get to a doctor. But I did go, and we looked and couldn't find and tested and didn't find.
And they didn't do full blood tests?
Well, the funny part is the full blood tests wouldn't have included an HIV test.
You check your blood pressure and your cholesterol.
They check everything, but you have to give permission for an HIV test. So by the time, it was kind of a Hail Mary. When I finally dragged into the emergency room that last time, I had lost about 50 pounds. I had lost my job a month earlier. I literally fell asleep at my work, which is crazy for what I do or did for a living. It was just insane. So I, for the first time in my life, I was on unemployment for a month, and I just literally almost couldn't get out of bed. And that final emergency room in Charlotte, North Carolina was... By then, I started having Kaposi sarcoma all over, so I had lesions all over my leg, and we knew, you know, something's desperately wrong.
And so then you were in the hospital, and what happened?
Actually, I didn't even stay in the hospital. One of the craziest moments of my life.
Coming up, Robert talks about being told that he had 6 weeks to live. You're watching Turning Stone Show.
I was diagnosed as a 41-year-old married man with end-stage AIDS. I passed away in the intensive care unit of Fletcher Allen Hospital in Burlington, Vermont for what seemed like 20 seconds, but for me, it seemed like eternity. There was a light, and it grew and grew. It was pure white. And it would be 2 years later to realize what happened was actually a near-death experience. This isn't about rationalizing your mistakes. It's about getting the hell up and doing something with it.
So you have a great business and you're ready to shout it to the world and start your marketing campaign letting everybody know just how awesome you are. You're looking for some great marketing that will get your business some exposure and create a real bang in your industry. I'm talking about a well-designed video that captures the what and the how of what you do. We help you capture your business. AZ Video Marketing.
Turning Stone Show, spiritual consciousness evolving.
This young girl, resident, I guess, or an intern, whatever you call them, she was new, and she told me that I had end-stage AIDS, and I had about 6 weeks, and that I should go home and get your affairs in order, and
Those were her words too.
Exact, yeah. And you think that's just TV? It's not. It's just so. I almost laughed like you were in a drama show here. You know.
Yeah.
If it weren't for this poor girl crying, telling me I was the first person she'd ever told,
right?
Mortifying. And
so they give her
brand new wife right there too.
Brand new doctor, and they go, "Here, go give the news. Yeah. You don't want to do
yeah.
it."
Good
so,
training.
And yeah. So then that's a good question. I want to keep going with that. But then also, like, so then your wife is there.
Yeah.
And then I guess she's been tested since. And then,
big fear was, who have I hurt now? And that sets in.
Mm-hmm.
And it's real. And it's raw. And thank God. I shouldn't say it like that. But thank God she was never infected. Our marriage was horrible, so we really didn't spend a lot of time together. So thank God for that, I guess. Sad, crazy thing.
The benefits of not having intimacy.
Yeah, but that was a big chunk. And, you know, when I was diagnosed terminal, I was basically bedridden. I went home, and they said they'd try to get me on a couple trials, but that never, those things.
Mm.
That's kind of like, just go home, we'll call you on a trial, and it never panned out, so. My wife ended up leaving, going her separate ways, and she called my family. And I had wanted to go home to Vermont to be with my family for the end. And so they came and got me.
And then what happened?
Well, by then I was in and out of consciousness, and so they poured me into a car and drove me all the way from North Carolina to Vermont. And they had tracked all the hospitals because I was really in big trouble, and I was sicker than sick. And, but we made it, and they put me right into the hospital course there, and I spent, the first week there basically in and out of coma. And they were fighting for ways to try to figure out a way to go. But by then, I had, again, diagnosed so late, I was riddled with what we call opportunistic infections.
Oh, yeah.
I had cancers, and I had all sorts of things inside of me that, without an immune system, my body just didn't even know.
Mm-hmm.
So, as it starts waking up, it finds these things. So it's just been one thing after another. But in that hospital for the first week was where I was in the intensive care unit and passed away. And evidently, it was only maybe a 20-second moment. It seemed, again, like eternity to me. And I just always thought it was a dream, but so real.
Yeah.
It's just, and something was different, obviously, but I just called it that because I just didn't know what else to call it.
Yeah.
And then, bang, you get this calendar, and, there's this dude from the lights in the calendar, and he was dead 28 years before you were born. So you connect the dots. And
now, the near-death experience is what saved my life. I've never had a near-death experience, but I've read hundreds and hundreds, maybe 1,000 near-death accounts, and there's some commonalities in them.
Yeah.
You have a life review. Some people don't have a life review. You're in another place. Yeah. Sometimes there's a light.
Always a light.
And in doing the research, I coming from a Bible-believing, fear-based, when you die, you go before God, and He's going to judge you. If you accepted Jesus as your atonement, sacrifice, substitutionary atonement, then you get to go to heaven. If not, then you burn in hell, and that's not your experience, nor was it the experience of most people. And the International Association for Near-Death Studies, which you mentioned in your book, and Dr. Atwater, PMH, Atwater, brilliant work.
Great research.
And you've had an interaction with her.
Yes.
So all of this research lets me know, hey, something's way better.
Yeah.
We're not getting judged. There's another thing. And you actually had choice. You're like, hey, you ready? And you're like, nope.
I still scratch my head at that. And and I don't read a lot of near-death experiences. I don't really even read consciousness books. It's really odd because you'd think I'd be hungry for them. But I read like trigonometry and physics and stuff that I just never cared about.
Yeah.
And when I pick up a near-death experience book, I just can't do it.
Yeah.
Or anything conscious, I find I'm just, I laugh through them because they're so similar to my thought process. And I'm not a big consciously educated man here. And I came back. It's just weird and freaky. And
so I love page 45 in your book.
Yeah.
There's a list of things that happened that you noted. And you're like, wow, these line up exactly with what Dr. Atwater talks about.
Yeah.
So give the viewers some context of that.
Well, we might have to pause because I don't have reading glasses on. So
all right. Well, I'll read it to you then.
Yeah. You want to read it instead? But that's a, you know, that's so, a portion of them for sure.
You know, just some things in here. There's a bunch of words here, right? So I'm not going to read everything here. You've talked about you didn't have a fear of death. Here's one poked out to me, resistant to church. You weren't bored. You were a little less competitive. Mathematics, you're more interested in math. You've got curiosity, connecting to animals, being more caring, being more loving, having less anger. And then you've got a 3 a.m. issue here. So give us some context about that.
The whole process for me has been one of, and maybe I should read more conscious books because I'm sure I'd find half my answers. But
like, oh, that explains it.
But I just kind of trip through it all,
yeah. You
know, and the 3 a.m. and why do I have to wake up at exactly 3:33 in the morning?
Yeah.
I mean, I love that I'm beautiful and childlike and love everything and everybody, but 3:33 in the morning is a little goofy. But yeah, and then you find out that that's a universal thing of where the energy's the highest. And so you start learning and just tripping through it. But one of the real passions I had in this near-death experience was, you're right, Dave, that all the experiences are so uniquely different with a few common...
Yeah, there's still ties.
You know,
yeah.
Ties. The light, the peace, the on and on. But what isn't different are 50 years of research on the after effects. And they're so creepily synchronistic that they just scream for you to pay attention. But it's so funny how people gravitate towards the drama of the experience. You look on my blog, there's hundreds of writings of stuff I don't even remember writing half of them. Mm. They're beautiful. But the near-death experience itself portion has been read thousands of times all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
The others, no. So I get it, the drama of the experience. What did he say in the light? Was it God? Is there a heaven? Is there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I get it. But at some point, we've got to start paying attention to 50 years of research because it was so ridiculously similar to my first 2 years not even understanding what happened to me and making all those notes and then turning around and finding out, this is me. These people are writing exactly what's happening to me. And really, it gives you a sense of community because, look, you can go to a psychologist for years to change one personality trait. Right? It's a lot of money. Near-death experiencers come back, even spiritually awakened people. You don't even have to die here, guys. You know that. They come back and change almost everything about themselves, seemingly overnight, without any effort. The effort comes in assimilating them back into your memory banks of what you were versus what you are now.
Mm-hmm.
I sometimes envy the child experiencer because they haven't really formed themselves yet. But the stark contrast of what I was, the ego driven 100 miles an hour, just success, career, speed, more speed, next
gotta
challenge.
Achieve, gotta get to
the American dream.
Make money.
And, you know, and here I'm writing a best-selling book and giving most of it to charity.
Yeah.
So it is just... not even black and white. It's just so ridiculously different that it's very shocking to people. And
so I don't want to lose context of the fact that, so when you die and you go to this space, you're not in this celestial heaven and the king crowns you worthy to be there. You're like, wow. And you felt love and peace. You didn't feel fear. You didn't feel like, oh, I'm going to burn. You didn't feel that.
And you know, back in my hospital bed, let's be honest, I had just been told, with the biggest head in the world, you know, that I'm dying with AIDS. So there was a tremendous amount of shame. Mm-hmm. I should have just gone. And in that experience, I didn't even blink. I said no. And the smile on his face, And then I touched him. And, you know, one thing we didn't talk about in that snippet was the only words that came after that, and that was it. And it ended, but it, gloriously, but he just, as I touched his face and the smile, that it was all-encompassing, he said, there's something important you're supposed to do. And I just, it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
So what's the two-year time span seems to be pretty common for most near-death experiencers, like where either they don't talk about it or you don't use, or like collecting, kind of almost like you're assimilating, like you talked about, the experience before you're able to really articulate it into language. Like, what's that? Just tell you a little bit about that.
You know, I think some people still struggle with it a lot, to put words to the ineffable. You know, to compare it to something is impossible. So when you try to explain the colors you saw there, you can never, there's no verb, there's no adjective that I can. The funny part is I wrote this my near-death experience in a 20-minute haze of glory and love and peace, and I've never changed a thing. I never even went back and said, oh, maybe. It's just so concrete in your soul, that it's a lot to deal with. There's a lot of things that come, and I know I get a lot of people, oh, that's beautiful. Well, it is. But it's a lot. It's a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, I start feeling energy from every human being on the planet. And I literally ran to a mountain cabin and hid out for 6 months. It was so bad.
Wow.
So, you know, there's an adjustment period, and then, you know, but finding that community, you're right, Jesse, it is almost average, about 2.5 years before the experiencer puts it together what happened to them. They know all the changes in them over that 2.5 years, but it's usually some shocking moment of holy cow, and they put it together that, you know, I get goosebumps talking about it, that epiphany moment where you realize that that was that dream that changed everything. I mean, I just thought I was grateful to be alive, but yet I'm, you know,
what were some of those things that you were, experiencing in those 2 years that made everything different? Like,
because I hear everybody talking about energy, and they're sensitive to energy after they come back.
It was
like their watches; they can't keep their watch going.
Yeah, I still can't.
It's almost like, so my mind's trying to really understand. So you this happens to you, and then you don't think about it again till 2 years later.
Oh no! Oh, no. Oh my no! No,
because like you're constant. Experiencing all these new things. So what are some of the things you were experiencing knew was different than before that had, like, what's going on?
It's a really great question. I did a lot of writing when I was sick because I was literally sick and bedridden, sometimes couldn't walk for days. So I did a lot of writing. But I had written 15 pages of differences I noticed, just in some real off-the-wall things, you know, like, the childlike naivety, it was almost like I was relearning how to be a human being again. I lost a lot of memory. I don't know if that's, I haven't heard a lot of that with other experiencers, but light, anything light was, I would be like, you have to pull me away.
Yeah.
It got dangerous at times. Wow. Electrical disturbances everywhere. I blew up so many computers before I understood what was happening. And you know, but you learn and you adjust. And Carol, my girlfriend, and we just have a deal. And when things start freaking out, I get at least 12 to 16 feet away and things calm down and we reset and move on. I wear a watch. It never is right. But I do it to remind me that if I'm in a really emotionally charged state and I walk into a room, that's why I don't do a PowerPoint in my speeches around the world. I try, you know, I was so excited the first couple. I look at this PowerPoint. You know, the entire room is buzzing and people's phones ring and just the lights flicker. So, yeah, it's a real deal. And you have to not be so scared of it because people, you know, it's so funny. My apartment, like I have cats that hang out from my apartment and the kids in the neighborhood call me a witch. So I, you know, it's. The perception of how I am now in that childlike way of you know, I trust everybody, I love everybody, yeah. almost to a point of fault.
Yeah.
And I do have yeah. to appreciate that. And Carol usually keeps me grounded with those things. But
yeah.
Nature, I could not stay indoors.
Mm.
And what was interesting was I actually had hypercalcemia. So it's a vitamin D overload, basically. You can't be in the sun.
Hmm.
You're a boy in the bubble kind of deal. So anytime I went out of the house, I had to have gloves, mittens in the middle of summer. So here I am. I can't stop. I just want to be outdoors, and I'm catching every sunset and sunrise. I think it went like 300 and some odd days. I never missed one.
Coming up, Robert talks about writing his book, 20 Seconds. You're watching Turning Stone Show.
Hi, I'm Jesse. Here's what you need to know about Chinese cupping. It's a great way to just tweak your body just enough to get increased performance, but also to release some of those areas of your body that you don't even realize are painful. And cupping and acupuncture are often used together, but it's an effective way to bring blood flow to a particular area of the body so it aids in rapid healing.
Welcome to Southwest Institute of Healing Arts. Holistic health offers so many positive possibilities. Feeling better inside and out, finding peace and serenity, energizing or relaxing yourself with massage, yoga, holistic nutrition, and many practices that support wellness and harmony of the mind, body, and spirit. Southwest Institute of Healing Arts is an award-winning, nationally accredited private college and community healing center for holistic healthcare careers and continuing education.
Turning Stone Show, Spiritual Consciousness Evolving.
You know, it was never a big deal until I went back a year ago and said, I got to write this story. And I had been through so much stuff that I started reviewing medical records. The nice part about my whole situation is it's so medically documented. It's bulletproof.
Yeah.
You know, it's impossible. But still, that looming thing from the Mayo was... We don't know what to tell you about the immune system because you can't function without one. And again, being caught so late, it's taking forever to come back. And it, you know, today I have about a third of your immune system 6 years later. So,
wow,
just weird.
Talk about calling your doctors around your bed.
Oh, yeah. That when I after the light in the face, and I woke up in my bed, and my sister was sitting next to me, kind of, and I sat straight up. You know, I couldn't even walk. And, you know, I'd been unconscious for days, if not weeks by then. And I had really given up. And so I sat straight up in bed, and I just kept uttering, there's something important I'm supposed to do. I need to see all of my doctors. I knew exactly what to do. I was clear. I was precise. I sat straight up, and I was twiddling my thumbs and just humming a tune. And they all came in, and I don't even remember there being a delay. I'm sure there was, but it just was all so beautiful. And and I always joke that, you know, by now I'd had so many specialists, and there were 12 doctors who came in, and I always joke about that. My apostles.
The 12 disciples, that's not the same.
I never heard a negative. I don't remember a negative. They all took their turn. I remember hearing it, it's going to be a haul, but never a no, you can do this.
Yeah.
And I just kept saying, I don't get it, I don't understand it, but I absolutely believe it so much that it gives me goosebumps talking about today. There's something important I'm still supposed to do.
And part of that, obviously, is the book, how writing that. And then what's next as far as... What do you see that you're moving into that's part of why you're still here and why you chose to come back?
Showing the vulnerability of this disease. It's ugly.
What's the ugliness about it and the rage?
You know, our society's come a long way with the gay population. And rightfully so. Maybe hundreds of years ago it should have, but be that as it may, 30 years ago we weren't there. I'm not sure we're all there yet. Let's be honest. But we're sure a heck of a lot further than we were 30 years ago when this disease, literally by our own politicians, was called the gay epidemic. And there were whispers in hallways and important people who said that this was God's will. I'm sorry.
Yep. You're 100% right. There's crazy people out there that have websites saying that God hates fags.
Yes.
And this is the reason the people in Afghanistan are the soldiers are dying is because he's punishing America. Because there's crazy people out there.
It is hard to fathom that a disease that literally can be stopped by human consciousness and choice alone.
Yep.
You don't even need a cure. You needed responsibility. And no judgment,
mm-hmm.
and a collective of people, not just gay people,
yeah,
every people,
mm-hmm.
to stand up and say, I get it. We can at least get tested, mm-hmm. right? We can get the 72% who aren't on medication on medication, yeah. so they mm-hmm. can't continue to spread
to propagate,
yeah. right? I literally sit back sometimes and have conversations with people, and they, how is this not even possibly happening already? And I don't get it. I don't get it. You get your cholesterol checked. You get everything checked. But when it comes to an HIV test, you A, have to ask.
Mm-hmm.
You B, have to fill out a sexual survey on your habits and performance. And now with that, if you can get past all those mortifyingly ridiculous things, then they might test you for HIV. That's at a hospital clinic. That's, you know, we can't have that mindset mm-hmm. on a disease that's killing
people. It's very stereotypical, the whole line of questioning that you have to go through to get an HIV test. It's really absurd.
I mean, now imagine sending a 15-year-old kid in there.
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. You're going to share your second. Yeah, I mean, come on.
Yeah.
We've got to get real about it.
Yeah.
And I think, frankly, two people dead are enough, but 36 million, I think it's time to.
And especially when you say you bring awareness to the population of females age 14 to 24. 13 to 24. That demographic of our daughters that are being infected with this disease, and there's no program, and we're just told, just don't just ignore it. Don't get them tested.
If I stand in front of 200 people and speak on an average, there might be one person in that room who knows those statistics that we talked about, mm-hmm. because they are shocking.
Mm-hmm.
And what are
and they're secretive almost, and I just don't get it. So,
If you're standing in a room and talking to 200 people, how many of those people statistically are going to be infected and not know it?
Mm. Wow. I don't know the answer to that.
It's a good question. Just the kind of what those statistics are based on.
Yes.
You know,
but what I like about it is that he's raising consciousness about it, and because he's hitting a new demographic,
mm-hmm.
you know, heterosexual white male in a family spouse situation, not the demographic we're looking for. Well, mm-hmm. he's bringing awareness to it. Hey, it's a shared community here.
But this is also not a conversation that people want to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And so how do we bring the conversation around to where it becomes a conversation that is talked about?
It's a great question.
That's part of what you're doing.
I think there are multiple facets to answer that, Jesse. But one of the big targets that we've landed on as far as what we think was tangibly, functionally possible, frankly, impossible not to even think this way, is that the CDC says, if we tested 100% of the people in this country, 100% of the time, we'd end the disease in a calendar year.
Mm. Wow. Say that again get that in my head.
That's your government.
Wait, yeah, say that one more time.
While they're doing nothing, is telling us if we just tested 100% of the people,
uh-huh.
100% of the time, and it became a standard procedure like your cholesterol, and we got the people the treatment that tested positive, we'd end it in a calendar year. 1 year.
Wow.
And we can't talk about legalizing testing. So that was one of the spawns of our book, was to, the president has read our book, we're tickled, and we're hoping
President-elect?
President Obama.
Yeah, former President Obama, because
President-elect Trump has
and his vice president seem to have different views on the subject.
Well, you know, it's funny, I think I'm not a political guy because it's just so nasty, but mm-hmm. you watch what happens with this guy. He might just be like crazy enough to get this kind of stuff
mm-hmm.
done.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're
because we've been running from year for years.
Yep.
And this is not new information mm-hmm. to the White House, guys.
Yep.
I mean, come on. So when you're sitting there in your government job going, there's another, you know, how many people a day? You know, there's seven women a day.
What do you say to somebody that just recently finds out that they're HIV positive?
Well, get them to a support group, get them to their community, because there's a learning curve with this this disease, obviously. It doesn't, like a lot of near-death experience books, you don't just have the experience and it goes away. And you live happily ever after. Yeah. This is brutal if it's not caught in time. And you know, my mistake, my bad, should be somebody else's lesson. That look, there is no possible way you would have gotten my big fat head into a door to be HIV tested until it happened.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And given the statistics, how many men are out there spreading the disease and how many women that's growing too, because men are being more promiscuous, not only with other men, but also with women, and you just don't know where it's coming from. And, you just don't know.
And in some circles, we're still having arguments about talking about birth control. We've got some work to do.
What do you mean about birth control?
There's still people that won't even let you discuss it with their children.
Oh, right. Yep. Yeah.
And, you know, it's, I get it, sort of.
Yeah. Hey, hey, kid, here's a condom.
Yeah.
This is going to save your life someday.
Here's my thing. You know, we can talk and all these dialogues and all these strategies, get to the White House, get this stuff in. But if we legitimately got HIV testing included in the bank of tests that you got, it would, in 2 or 3 years, it would become so commonplace that no one, we wouldn't have to discuss it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, we can keep forcing condoms. We can keep forcing needles and we can keep trying to attack the symptoms.
Yep.
But I just think it's just about, you know, just being real about the damn thing. This disease never discriminated.
Yep.
We did.
Mm-hmm.
And God watched.
Mm-hmm.
How long, and I just have ignorance to this topic, but how long can you go without having any symptoms?
I think it varies per person.
It does, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, there's a general, you know, you're going to start noticing right away. In fact, years prior to my really knowing I was sick, I started getting weird things like Rocky Mountain spotted fever. You know, like, how'd you get that? Well, a tick. But still, it just was weird. Stuff kept coming up.
Were you ever to go back to the point of where it actually began? Have you done any work to get back to, like, how long you had HIV before it moved into AIDS?
According to science, although the viruses are several different kinds of HIV. Right, yeah. Some are a lot more aggressive. But according to medical science, to get from HIV infection to end stage AIDS where I was can be anywhere from 9 to 11 years I walked around with this disease.
Mm.
And no one wants to talk about this awkward part, but I was having sex.
Yeah, that was my next question. So how does your wife,
you know, we got to talk about it, because that, when you're laying in the hospital bed, folks, whether you can live with the shame of the disease, or was it the shame of what you possibly did to another human being because you were too stupid and arrogant to just get tested?
What do you think about, you know, the new medication now that's out called PrEP that a lot of people are beginning to use to avoid
fantastic the technology disease? It's one of my pills in my regimen.
So you were on PrEP as well as something else?
It wasn't originally PrEP. That medication was actually an antiviral medication.
Oh, okay.
It just got discovered that if you had, accidental unprotected sex and you were worried, you can take this medication now. For those of you who don't, it's a 30-day supply, and it's been shown to be, I believe, 98-99% effective in killing the virus right from the start.
And that's basically something you take daily, then?
Well, for $1,800 a bottle, yes.
Oh,
unless your insurance covers it?
It won't, on PrEP.
Insurance won't cover PrEP at all?
No, not that I know of.
Wow.
That's weird. I know lots of people on PrEP.
I don't know how they're doing it. I don't know, honestly. It's not something that we've had to worry about. I mean, I've been on that medication since the start, so my viral load is, if I join the Army tomorrow, they couldn't even find it in my blood. It actually takes a special test.
Yeah. So what medication are you on?
I'm on Truvada, which is the PrEP,
mm-hmm.
and I take that once a day, and then another drug called Tivicay. And really, each of those drugs are actually like three or four mm-hmm. mixed together. It's mm-hmm. a cocktail.
That's the cocktail.
Yeah.
But not everybody's on a cocktail.
HIV actually is, it's a very strange disease because it morphs. It changes mm-hmm. and it hides. So you can wipe it out, but it hides in little reservoirs. And it actually evolves and becomes resistant to these antivirals. So the antivirals become five pills in one to keep the disease going, what the hell's going on. Mm-hmm. Some of the issues with the medication, legitimately, obviously, other than the expense, which is absurd, they're pretty toxic. Mm-hmm. And some sure. people don't handle them well.
What are some of the things that happen to one's body?
Liver is the big concern. You know, you've got to remember this is a 10-15 year cycle that we've had this. I'm not exactly sure all that's in yet. We're literally finding as we're discovering that, and I hate it that this might happen, but we might turn around later and say, oh boy, that hurt people. And I get that too.
Senator, we had another episode where we talked about the liver, and what was it? The liver is like the consciousness, or the liver holds the consciousness of old, like.
For that.
It had something to do with past lives in the liver and some pains that you had stored there. So take care of your
and
liver.
And so it's interesting that specifically having HIV, liver is specifically one
liver,
of the,
kidneys are the
organs
ones,
that
the
are
big
yeah
concerns.
The kidneys too that are specifically mm-hmm. concerned.
You know, but what really was amazing about you, so you've got a book, you're an Amazon number one bestseller international, and people need to know you don't take every single penny of this. You didn't buy an airplane. You don't live in a mansion. I know that you do not have a Rolls Royce. You live a very simple, very conscious lifestyle. What do you do with the profits from this book?
Well, that's a great question because I didn't, you know, I see a lot of near-death experiencers writing their book, and I don't think profit's a dirty word. It just was deeper than that here for me that I don't know if you've ever tried to actually raise money for HIV and AIDS. It ain't an easy one.
I bet.
So I wanted to make it so simple that you just couldn't ignore it. So we created a charity called GAB, and it's short for Give a Buck.
Give a buck.
A little bit of slang, give a buck, but it was to get...
With a B.
Buck.
Or an F, depending on which way you're
well,
thinking.
Well, our t-shirts are an asterisk. So, it's just about somewhat shaking the soul of the world a little bit and saying, you can't sweep it away anymore. The irony of 30 years ago, the very children of the men like me are now the targets. You know, it's just time to talk about it. That's all.
Yep.
That's all we're trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
So we give a dollar. You know, now keep in mind, every time this gets bought on Amazon, we make $1.56. And I take a dollar. And we give the dollar to Gab Charity. And then we ask the reader, if you're moved, touched, or at least tell me you understand, would you donate a buck?
Yeah.
You know, the dream was crazy, maybe. 7 billion people, $1 a piece. Who cares about the dollar?
Yeah.
But just to have one more human being go, I get it. Get it.
Coming up, Robert talks about bringing awareness to his charity that is near and dear to his heart on The Turning Stone Show.
The McLean Meditation Institute is a center here in Sedona, Arizona. Pilgrims and spiritual seekers from all over the world come here. I've created this center so they can have a real experience of meditation, whether they're here for an afternoon, or they're here for a week, or they want to come to a retreat. So here at the center, we have a beautiful gift store. We have a lot of contemplative artists and books, and a nice meditation center where you can sit down and meditate or join one of our programs.
Hi, I'm Martin Baratella. I've written four books. Every one of the books is titled Field of Love from an experience that I had a number of years ago. This one right here, which is called Field of Love, How to Experience the Field, is a book of some of my most intense experiences. The Kindle version of this book is free, so I just say, go on to Amazon if you like that book. This big book is my memoir, The Unfoldment of Consciousness Can Look Like When You Don't Censor It at All.
Turning Stone Show, Spiritual Consciousness Evolving.
you know, we've had thousands of books sold, but the charity limps along. I think we've had, I mean, it's an international best-selling book, and I've had 18 people give to the charity.
Wow.
And I don't mean to be blue about it. It just tells me we've got a lot more work to do.
Yeah.
But I've had people literally for a dollar, 20 seconds worth of time. Imagine that. You could go on and donate a dollar. 18 people.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's scared people. It's awoken people.
Yeah.
I think one of the best parts for us was, you know, the movie's going to be great and all these things coming and the documentaries. And we're just thrilled to share our story. Just for that one bit of hope, you know, with the near-death experience and understanding that I survived all these things without an immune system, that there really is the possibility of almost anything in this world.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just so important to you know, sing that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, do it with a purpose and a cause. And a lot of people said, oh, this is the next near-death experience book. Really isn't.
Yeah, it's so much more than that. I mean, yeah. You've gave context of where you were, how you got there, what happened to you, what your journey is now, and it's still unfolding.
Yeah. And, you know, I try to, you know, on one page you're laughing at my humility and some of the things I went through. It's how I did a lot of it, was we tried to laugh through it and keep it light and just. But, you know, going back and writing that book and reviewing all that stuff, I found things that I had no idea were as serious as they were. At the time, they were just like, yeah, you got to wear mittens, you know, when you go in the sun.
Okay.
But the fact was, if I had 15 minutes of sun on more than 20% of my body, I'd stroke out. They didn't tell me that. But you know what? You see what I'm saying? So you go back and read all this stuff and go, holy.
Yeah.
What the hell?
So you were in Yvonne Sneden's film called Back from the Light. It was a great documentary. I encourage you to check it out. And we're hoping to have Yvonne on a future episode of Turning Stone Show.
Yeah.
How did you make that connection? And you talked about not having a near-death experience, but what happens after you come back and you try to integrate back to a normal life?
You know, some of the guttural power in that story is sharing how I dealt personally with these after effects. And a lot of near-death experience books don't really get into the shame and the nitty-gritty of laying in your own vomit. You know, I mean, come on. They're positive, beautiful books, and mine is too.
Now you can say diarrhea on the show.
Okay. But, you know, it's... I mean,
you've got to
bring the good with the bad. Yeah. And if you're not going to bring them into the dark, they're not going to appreciate the light. Yeah. So it's guttural, and it's tough, and I get it. But the whole thing just ends with such a wow love story that, you know, it's hard not to pay attention to what really saved me here. And that was a really, just like you guys, at exactly the right time and manner, we connect, we work together to share this story, your business, my business, and we all grow from it.
Yeah.
And that was the legitimate call when we put this book out. I didn't even have the money to publish. I did a Kickstarter.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Really?
So the whole damn thing was just, whatever you tell me, I'll just keep following, and it just kept happening. You know, from the IONS conference, I got interviewed by a Chinese television station. So my story went viral in China 2 weeks after my book hit the market.
That's amazing, because they have such restrictive media laws.
Well, then it got black marketed, and it's now selling for $68 a book there. So, and I can't do anything about it. But
and they don't give a buck.
But no, of course not. I don't. My publisher's mad. But
publisher's bucking mad.
Well, it's a self-published. You know, I paid to publish, so it's not like, you know, they're knocking down the doors. But now that we've hit the bestseller, I think, you know, we're trying to find the next step is to find a publisher who can support this right. I mean, it's obviously, I've done the work. It's now just needs to be supported and get out there. Mm-hmm. So we're working with producers on movies, and that's a crazy business. So no offense to you guys. TV.
Well, you can share your wonderful video vignette with them.
Yeah.
So they can have some context about your story.
Yes.
Because that's what we offer here at the Turning Stone Show.
Yeah, it really came out great. So I'm grateful for that. But, you know, that... Jesse, I keep going back to your question because you know, how did you know what was different? And so many things that we could discuss, and I probably didn't even write them all in the page after page after page in that book, but I still find things, you know, now, 6 years later, and according to PMH and other researchers and scientists, this series of conflicts and push and pull with these after effects will continue for years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with it.
Mm-hmm. What do you see as next for you as far as, like, you've written the book and you've got all these things that you're working on.
Yeah.
What's kind of that shining light for you, so to speak?
And no pun intended.
Yeah.
That is the work to do that you came back for.
I want to see legislation.
Mm-hmm. What would you like to see changed?
That testing become as routine as testing your red blood cells.
Mm-hmm.
Shouldn't be any different.
Yep.
Sorry.
And there's no reason why we couldn't.
Cholesterol's not
going to
kill you tomorrow.
At an international
level. You're not
going
to walk out if I don't test your cholesterol and poison 20 other people with your
cholesterol. At an international level?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it can't happen just at a national level.
No.
It has to happen at an international level.
I think it can
level.
Start at a national
at a global.
Level. Mm-hmm. But I think you need somebody a little bit to get it done. I don't know if Trump's your man, but...
it's not my man. Don't point at me.
He might be just crazy enough
yeah.
to say... What the hell's wrong with you people?
Let's hope so.
Well, what we learned
how did this become political? They're dying.
We learned from Suzanne Giesman that we're expecting the best. We're putting the positive out there. We're not expecting the worst, saying, oh, this is going to be... We're expecting the best.
Yeah.
And then we give him the opportunity
absolutely.
To do the best.
To rise to the occasion.
Rise
to be
the
giraffe
occasion.
That rises above
yep.
to find the green grass.
Yep.
Because everything else is dead below.
This testing thing, if it's the last breath I take.
Yep.
Because you know why? It isn't... Should we? Shouldn't we? There is absolutely no unequivocal question that it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And about 30 years overdue. It's not if, it's when. And it's going to take somebody to be a loose wheel
mm-hmm.
and stick their toe in the spokes and get rough about it maybe a little bit. I don't know, but we'll get it done.
Obviously, it's a rough conversation to have with friends and family and coworkers, you know, once you've learned your diagnosis. What was that journey like for you and having those conversations with your family and friends and people you work with? And where are they at in your life now? I guess that's kind of the question. Like, I know a lot of that, just like people go away,
it
people
did.
Show up,
yeah,
people stay.
It's actually a topic. I've been writing for every day for since this. That's something I kind of woke up with, too. I was never a writer. It just,
oh, wow. That's fascinating.
When I wrote that book and the five others I've written in the last year,
wow.
I won't even remember writing it. I just go somewhere else.
Boom. Yeah.
I'll spend days. I won't even eat. Carol can't even get me out. I just, it's weird.
Yep.
And I don't fight it. I giggle.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about stuff that I'm like, I should never know any
yeah.
of this stuff.
Wow.
It
and
gets
so
a
part of that's
freaky,
been around relationships and how that
yeah.
economy changed.
You know, one of the hardest things about writing this book was looking back because I really portrayed my survival as a collective effort of love. But there was the yin and yang of that too. Jesse, in the sense that, and I, my desire to be positive and hopeful in this book probably led me to leave some of that out. But people ran,
Bet.
People made choices out of fear, out of stigma,
mm-hmm.
out of who knows. Somebody once told me, you know, when people are dying, some people just don't know what to do.
Yeah.
They don't know what to say. They don't
yeah.
know what to... I get it.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always been told you have to respect people who just handle things differently
yeah.
than you.
Mm-hmm.
Still hurts.
Spoken from somebody who's never been in hospice.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm telling you...
You've been in hospice. That's
right. There, you will decide
mm.
how important people are to you.
Mm.
And my topic was... Some people just gave me 20 seconds, and it was enough.
Mm.
Some people gave me a lot more.
Yeah,
but I sucked every bit of love out of anybody who'd offer it, and it's a rough deal when some of them turned and ran. Some of my closest people, in fact, and when I told them I was writing a book coming out about the HIV and the near-death experience, and I love them, but 80% of my family hightailed it.
What would you say?
I love them for it. It actually made me better.
I love that you love them.
They survived. They helped me survive.
Yeah.
And then I want to do something, and they went.
But I love that you love them.
And people went, and it literally caught the book on fire. Mm-hmm. So if everything that happens exactly the way it's supposed to.
Yeah.
And if you just stop fighting it and try to.
Yes.
I mean, sometimes you got to dig hard to find the one piece of gratitude out of
it. Keep going and you'll find it.
After 6 years, I find one string and I'm a lunatic with it.
So I've got my.
Never get it out of my fingers.
I've got my yearly doctor checkup coming up. And so they do a panel of blood tests. If I say, hey, I want to do an HIV screen, is there an enormous cost to that or is it a routine cost?
No, in fact, on our website, we have a direction. There's everywhere in this country you can even go get a free HIV test anywhere in this country. They're all free.
Yeah.
If you do it through your doctor, there's going to be some charge to your insurance.
Getting the test is, you can do it for free if you go to a screening clinic. So there's no excuse for you not to get it done.
Even like they're going to the most counties, well, you can get it
Department of Public Health
free.
Would it help if I then make people aware by posting it on my social media Facebook page saying, hey, I had a screening this week. Blood test was great.
Yeah.
The cholesterol was great. And I did an HIV screening so I can be aware of my health.
I think it's really important for absolutely people who aren't in the risk factor to be okay with saying, hey, look what I did.
Yeah.
Like, you know the I voted sticker?
Yes.
Why the hell wouldn't you have one for I just saved 20 people down
did
the road,
you,
maybe?
Did you, do you have a sticker? That you should make a sticker.
No, I know,
just
got my We have t-shirts, hats. So, I mean, we got it all.
Yeah, you've got merch. Yeah.
Yeah, we did some merchandise for it, and it trickles along.
So I have another question there. So what would you say to someone who is positive under treatment and chooses not to share that with others because of
you
the
mean
stigma
sexual behavior or sexual partners or just people
anyone
in I think it's
because
a very
once
personal
you're,
thing
because once you're
be
on treatment the likelihood of you transmitting the disease to anyone else is
absolutely
and so there's doctors that would say there's no reason to share and then there's doctors that are going to say it's up to you, it's a personal choice.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's an option with your, I mean, I've had to have the conversation 3 times with people I've dated, and it's a mortifying conversation, too.
How do you ease into that one?
Dude, there ain't no book on that one.
Just so you know, by the way, I got a little something to tell you.
There might should be, because it's,
but do you think it's a conversation
before you ever get romantic with somebody, my question's always been, do you tell them right from day one?
Right.
Or when you get to that point where you're going to be a physical thing and we need to talk.
Yeah.
You know, all 3 times, to these people's credit, frankly, or whatever, or maybe where we're going. But, you know, in 6 years, I've dated 3 times, and I've had to have this conversation. All 3 times, they were like, I'm in.
Hmm.
Whatever.
That's beautiful. That's love.
Well, it's not really that.
And it's not fear.
It is. Okay. And also, the more you've where you are and where you deal with it also gives the space and energy for them to be okay with it because you're knowledgeable and you're sharing that knowledge with them and you're educating them.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they, I mean, we sat down with my immediate family, Carol and her kids, and said, this is what we want to do. And I was scared to death.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that were the first people I really came out and said, I'm about to tell the world that I made the biggest mistake of my life that's turning out to be the best benefit maybe to the ever that I
planet.
Give to the world.
Sure.
And is this the important thing? Probably not.
It's just the message that gets it out there.
You know what the important thing was? I think about this all the time because I used to joke, you know, you can't be more specific. You're God. I mean, you know, and I joke about my experience a little too because it's, you know, it's too serious isn't good either.
Yeah.
So, but I, you know, that important thing I was supposed to do was right there standing in front of that line. It was why I didn't delay saying no when back in my bed I was dead with shame and embarrassment. Standing in front of that light was the important thing. It was right where I forgave myself and began to love myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I forgave myself in front of that light. And I got up from that bed and Now, don't get me wrong. It wasn't, you know, puppies and rainbows.
Mm-hmm. So not everybody
crawl sometimes.
Not everybody gets to have that near-death experience, to have that moment where they can forgive and love themselves again mm-hmm. inside that. So what would you share with somebody who is diagnosed and then they've got to go through that whole process of forgiveness, not only for themselves, but also for partners and for and loving themselves.
Well,
it's a whole new journey.
And I'll bring this up because I'm not a doctor, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a relationship expert, or I'm not even a life coach. Okay. My life coach for me was rub some dirt on it. You're gonna be all right.
Yeah.
So
school of hard knocks.
I'm obviously different now, but at the same time, you know, I talk about some new science here because let's be candid, and you guys know this, our high school biology just ain't cutting it, okay? I mean, we're literally, with our ability to connect in this world with the internet now, science is doubling every single day what we know.
Wow,
that's amazing.
Imagine that. Yeah. So we're growing so
doubling.
Fast.
That's
doubling.
Incredible.
Every day. Yeah. Mm. So think about that for a minute, you know, and why we continue to do things.
How do you
the
even
same
wrap
way.
Your head around that?
It's amazing. Yeah. So this is important. But new science is showing us that, I know it's a deep, heavy responsibility, and people, I would have fought this. But almost everything about disease isn't coming from our DNA.
Mm-hmm.
It's blueprinted there. But we're the ones who get to snap the switch. We're the ones that the fear turns that signal on or off. It is just that simple. Mm-hmm. The real question is, how the hell do you do it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you have to die? Do you have to have these crazy experiences mm-hmm. where, you know, some dude in light? And I don't think you do. Mm-hmm. You know, we see spiritually awakened people.
Mm-hmm.
I'll share this with you. I just found this recently. Back in the 1970s when Raymond Moody put out the first near-death experience book, they did a poll. Approximately 4 to 5% of the population had had a near-death experience back then. That's about 15 million people. 2014, we redid a new poll after 40 years or whatever it is. It's probably time, right? Because you know and I know things have been going on around here.
Yeah.
The last 8 or 10 years, mm-hmm. people have kind of been waking up.
Yeah.
And I love it. I just sit back and giggle because I know it'll happen when they need it, when they need it.
Yeah.
Let's hope it happens sooner than later for my children.
Well, you can, you know,
it's coming.
Who would believe it, you know? It's just, but you wake up and realize that it's more than just whether or not you have a choice standing in front of a light. Mm-hmm. You have a choice in your health. You have a choice in what you're scared of.
Yeah.
And when you get rid of or overcome these fears,
mm-hmm.
it's the secret to good health.
Yeah.
What were the statistics in 2014?
Mm, yeah.
Did they increase or
blow you away? We instead of near death experience, because that's so focused, we did spiritually awakened.
Mm.
That was the poll for 2014. 57% of the population has had some sort of spiritual transformative event.
Yeah.
Wow.
Really.
Coming up, Robert talks about the population that is having a great spiritual awakening on The Turning Stone Show.
I'm a teacher and I'm a coach, and my purpose is to really help other people find their purpose and to not settle. Most of the time they're stuck and they want something more for themselves. You know, what I do for them is I help them get clarity. I'm very grounded, like I have a calming energy for people. And I teach them how to listen to their intuition and get really quiet. We have to really listen to what the truth is within ourselves and trust it.
Turn Your Life Inside Out is a book of articulations. Each page is a completely separate topic. This book is a pocket guide of support and reminders to give you what you need just when you need it the most. If you're listening to this now, it's because you've already chosen to head your life in the direction of your greatest dreams. If you open this book to any random page, you'll notice it's not so random at all.
Turning Stone Show, spiritual consciousness evolving.
It just amazes me that's more than half the population that are now waking up.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, you can't just ignore it. You just can't. It depends on the severity of your experience that caused you to awake. But the whole funny thing is, it's so, people who have no idea, like I would have never known this, but if you walk into a spiritual conference and you see all, you felt it, you beautiful people, every one of those people have been to hell and back and lived to tell about it. That's, they didn't die, they didn't have all near-death experiences, but that's what awakening is.
Yeah.
A star doesn't get born without a collapse of energy. Everything has to collapse to expand. And it's that rock bottom of where there's nowhere left to go.
Yep.
And you go up.
Yeah.
The problem is, sometimes it's faster than you want. And it does leave a wake behind you and will drag people with you. It's different being me now or being an experiencer.
Is your childlike state, I love that you said that, like you became more childlike. Has that been impacted as time goes on? Like you become more...
I'm more cognizant of how people watch me. But no, it hasn't changed. If I find myself in a... That's why sunrises and sunsets are my thing. I just... If I find myself in a moment of beauty, I lose time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And I just kind of go somewhere else. Maybe that's my meditative state of gratitude of every morning. But when you try to tell somebody who's not been through some of these things, that when you wake up at first light, when it first warms your face every day, all I do is say, thank you. And if you really want to explain that to somebody, and you can't, because you, really the only true emotion to make you understand, which I'll never change you, is to choke you until you stop breathing, maybe. I don't know, but you literally want so much to tell people.
Stop
fighting.
Yes.
Son of a gun.
Yeah.
It's going to take you. Life is going to take you. Not unlike an inner tube on a river.
Yeah.
But you can steer. And that's in direct proportion to your attitude and how you deal with things every single day. You're not making this for me. I'm perceiving this how I want it to be.
Yeah.
And by God, there has to be some logic in the fact that when you die, and now you're not, you're just damn lucky to be here.
Yeah.
But it's more than that. And it changes us.
Yep.
I mean, my blood pressure dropped. My body temperature's 3 degrees lower than yours.
Wow.
So there's not just psychological, there's physiological and physical things that go on here that are, you just can't ignore them anymore.
Yeah.
And I get it. Read the experience. But read the after effects. Because what's amazing is that the 57% of those people we're finding out about, there's more. They just haven't put it together yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not just talking near-death experiencers. The world's changed. Mm-hmm. It's gotten tough.
It is. Mm-hmm. And that's what the Turning Stone Show...
People are going through hard times.
We're about spiritual consciousness evolving. We're about working together to grow forward.
And not being afraid of it.
And having no fear about it. Because in the end, all there is love. Boom, hit it.
Come on.
That's right. So, Robert Tremblay, thank you so much for being on our show.
It's a pleasure.
This book is, first of all, it's a delight to read. It's very engaging. Once you pick it up, you just want to absorb every page. You can't stop. It's informational. And most importantly, it has... a serious message behind it. This book has some gravitas, my man. I appreciate you being here to give us more awareness of HIV, being HIV positive, having the autoimmune deficiency syndrome that then allows more things to be aware of, more things. You're taking away fear and stigma and just your very willingness to share it, to be transparent with the world. Thank you for being of service.
It is indeed a pleasure to be here with you folks, but your message that you're putting out there for me is, this is huge. It isn't publicity. It's 1,382 people have sent us their HIV tests after reading that book.
Wow.
That was the gift we never thought of or expected. So the dollar be damned.
Yeah.
1,382 people. 5 tested positive.
Do you have stories on your website where people can share... Where they can, what do you mean, did they make it?
They were tested too late.
Oh, Yeah.
And then what happened?
They passed away in 3 months.
Oh, wow.
And then Jesse says, and then what happened?
But it was...
That's not a near-death account. It's a death account.
It brought me together with their family, and I was able to be a part of that process and that passing. And so, yeah, it was important. But four of them tested early, and I was able to help them connect with... You know, I'm not the expert on counseling people, so I get them to the people who can help.
That's good.
At least get them into a community that is, you know, so you're not alone. That is one of the biggest aspects.
Do you have something on your website where people can... I see something on your website, maybe it's there, maybe it's not there, yeah, but something where it's an interactive where people can say, hey, I got tested today and here's my results. Or there's a story time where people can share about their experience.
There is. It most people just... They do it confidentially and quietly and send me a confidential email right through the website.
Right, I get that. But you're really wanting people to bring this into a everyday conversation. So how
sense
can
of community.
We bring it into a community conversation where people are more willing to share it publicly?
Well, if you could answer that for me.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have a great presence on Facebook.
It gets there. Yeah, I mean, it does get there. It's just... To bring people into a disease that they've ignored for 30 years, you can only do it one way. Big emotion.
Mm.
Sorry.
Is it like shocking them?
And is it because...
Yeah, maybe, but, you know, just being real. And that is real. Yeah. And feel it. And I think that's important. It's time we stop.
Is it because it was the gay disease for so long?
I believe so. I believe that's exactly what it is. And I think some of it is, I think a lot of us get it now, but I suspect a lot of us aren't willing to forgive ourselves for how we decided how to handle this 30 years ago.
That's good.
And I think we need to stop that. Stop. I mean, I did. Mm-hmm. Whatever it takes to find the forgiveness. But look, 30 years doing the same thing over and over, and we're expecting different results. I know this.
Yep.
I'm willing to try anything at this point. So I don't have a gazillion great ideas, but people I meet do. And people take the responsibility of understanding that there really isn't one direct way.
Yeah.
So everybody just has to do one thing. 20 seconds worth of something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything. One dialogue. One kid. Let's get it into our schools. That's another thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to get it into the prisons. But really, education maybe doesn't have to be so promptly judicious if we just all got tested.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can end it.
Mm-hmm.
That's we can keep doing the same thing, mm-hmm. or we can get a little more serious about it. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know. This conversation it could keep going.
I know.
It's a wonderful conversation.
A
Thank you for being here.
Thank you
for sharing your message. Guys, this is a really important book. You're going to learn some stuff. You're also going to be able to support a very good cause of bringing awareness to the fact that we need to have testing. We need to find out, are you HIV positive? If you are, there's hope. And if you're not, great. Find out how you can stay that way. And if people can get tested, we can find out. Robert says we can put an end to the disease within a year if we had testing for everyone. So I encourage you to get the book. Web information's on the screen. This is awesome. Again,
thanks for being here.
Thank you. Now is the time on the show where we like to have a turning stone. And with this week's turning stone, we go to Jesse.
The question to ask ourselves this week is, what does your consciousness desire to experience in this moment of time that would have it be fulfilled? So today's conversation with Robert was filled with inspiration, education, and definitely pulled a lot of heartstrings as far as the difference that this conversation can have at a huge level. I mean, having everybody test for HIV in a one-year cycle would actually end the epidemic. That's huge. So this week, your assignment, your turning stone assignment for the week is to go get tested. Knowledge is power. And share on Robert's website, share, buy the book, give a buck, give a fuck. Go fucking get tested and share on Robert's website, share his message, and share with others that you have got tested and ask others if they've gotten tested. We love you and have an amazing week. And remember, this is a show about questions and questioning. It is not a show about answers. Nothing we say here is the truth. It is up to each of us to discover our own truth.
And join us each week on The Turning Stone Show as we continue the journey of conversations.
Subscribe and stay in touch with us. Get connected and join in the conversation.